And thank you for joining us for this discussion, Migration, Moving Beyond Crisis. I'm Kavita Menon, Editorial Director for Doctors Without Borders, based in New York. Some of you may know Doctors Without Borders by our French name, Médecins Sans Frontières, or MSF. Today, we're talking about MSF's work with people on the move as we get ready to mark World Refugee Day this Sunday, June 20th. As a medical humanitarian organization, we now have 50 years of experience working with people forced from home, and we are constantly adapting to meet new challenges. We'll talk today about some of the big migration trends and the individual human beings at the center of our work. Joining me today are Sergio Martin, head of mission for MSF's medical projects in Mexico. Hello, Sergio.
Hello, Kavita. Good morning, and thanks for this invitation.
Great to see you. Nice to see you again. And Aurélie Pontieu, coordinator for MSF's forced migration team based in Brussels. Welcome.
Hello, everybody. Thank you very much. Nice to be here.
Before we dive into the conversation, a few quick housekeeping notes. This discussion will run for about 45 minutes, and wherever you're joining from today, you can submit questions for our panelists. So thanks to all of you who already sent in questions via our social channels. If you're watching on live stream, YouTube Live, Facebook Live, or Twitch, you can send questions in the comments section or the chat section, and our team members will pass them on to me. We'll get to as many questions as we can, and we'll prioritize questions directly related to today's discussion. There are also live captions for this event, which you can view on a separate URL, and we're going to add that link in the chat. So let's start with you, Aurélie. Tell us a bit about what you do as coordinator of MSF's forced migration team.
So my team is working in a department that provides in the world in defining operational responses and advocacy strategy around migration issues. So we advise our missions in the field how to position MSF, how to provide the best assistance we can, how to make sure people access protection, and we advocate in that respect towards the different stakeholders, including government.
And so what's your perspective on the so-called global refugee crisis and that we see in the headlines?
Well, every year, unfortunately, we hear that the number of forcibly displaced in the world is growing. So obviously, it's a key concern. But we're dealing actually with a lot of different crises. So there's not such thing as a global crisis of displacement. We are dealing with different situations in different regions. But we also see major trends. And we can see, for example, that certain policies that are trying to limit people's movement, deter people from moving and crossing borders, are replicating in different regions. So we can see states getting inspired from one another. Mm-hmm. And that's a problem because we see that it's a source of suffering and humanitarian and medical needs in different regions. So a lot of challenges, but also very complex factors that push people to move, sometimes for very different reasons, and common trends linked to natural disasters, conflict, and climate change as well, that is for sure going to increase even further the number of people that are going to be forced from their homes in the future.
Yeah, Sergio, let's zoom in on one context in particular. As MSF's head of mission in Mexico, you've seen up close the impact of state policies and really charged language around the refugee crisis or the migration crisis, and how these things make life even more difficult for people on the move. So I wonder if you can talk a little bit about that. What kind of medical care does MSF provide along the migration route, and what are the needs that we see?
Yeah, we're currently working on the Americans all along the migration route from Panama till the US-Mexico border. And we are providing medical care, basically, and mental health care. And I'm very linked to what Aurélie is doing within and together with her department, giving voice and witnessing and giving a voice to the people we work with, right? Beyond that, we see migration as a very political issue, a very political affair. And what we witness is the impact of this politicization, if I can say it like that, right, of this matter. And we forget and we can see how politicians are forgetting sometimes that we are talking about people. And you can see very clearly the impact of the different policies. We're taking any single excuse to harden migration policies everywhere in the world, also in the Americas. We have seen that with new governments trying to gain votes, that has been very clear, but also with the pandemic and using the policies that at the end are pushing people to more violence along the road where we are working. We see many sexual, many from Central America region, Honduras, El Salvador, leaving their places because they have no choice, because they are suffering violence, they are suffering torture, they are suffering their threats, see how their children are recruited by the Mara police and be forced to move. Within a very, very complicated and difficult route, right? Mm-hmm. And sometimes we have seen governments that with the policy of the remain, the famous policy, people in the middle of border Mexican towns, very dangerous, and forcing them and forcing families and women to right. So it's not only the problem and the violence. The policies are also putting people in danger, and we should not forget that. And I think it's more and more, and already can talk more on that for sure. People in danger, really, and are part of the problem sometimes, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think, Aurélie, what do you see from the European side?
Yeah, and unfortunately, the European policies are a source of inspiration in many other regions. So we see 50 years, we've seen the asylum system in Europe being restricted to become almost nothing today. We are really shrinking the definition of who is a refugee, trying to put obstacles on people's ways, trying to deter them. And that's really, I mean, the common denominator of these policies is deterrence, is that this is what comes first. It's not about protecting human lives, dignity, offering asylum. It's really the first intent is to deter people from coming. So you have people that are basically hostages of these policies and kept in miserable conditions so that they can send a message to other people that would dare, you know, to come to Europe. And we've seen these policies unfolding under our eyes in the last years. We would never have imagined that we would have such a restrictive asylum system in Europe in 2021. And every day we hear new changes, new legislations. We just released a report about the situations in Greece and the Greek islands. And we are really denouncing the model that is being put in place by the European Union, which is a deterrence model that aims at doing this very artificial triage between who deserves protection, who doesn't deserve protection. And even those who deserve protection, they are very few today. We cannot even know who deserve the protection of Europe, because even Syrian refugees are supposed to ask asylum elsewhere. And one of the consequences is obviously a lot of human suffering and people dying on the way and suffering very miserable conditions in Europe.
I feel like even these terms of, you know, the refugee, asylum seekers, you know, all these terms themselves have become, you know, quite politicized and even used in a pejorative way as this whole, you know, people seeking safety, we have this slogan that we use at MSF, seeking safety is not a crime. Like, we have to remind people it is a right to seek asylum. This is an international right. This many domestic laws also exist to protect the rights of refugees and asylum seekers. But can you explain why that matters and kind of where we are now with the kind of international protection regime?
Well, it's a very important question, because obviously the definition of refugee, the one that is the most universally applied, which is the one of the 1951 UN Geneva Convention, that is the definition of who is a refugee, obviously is also a political construction. You know, this is, of course, governments agreeing in 1951 of who they wanted to protect and who deserved the protection of the state. And this definition today is inadequate. We know that we, and in our patients everywhere we work, we see that a lot of people need protection that is not found in the Geneva Convention. You have people that, and again, talking about, you know, the climate emergency, we know it's going to be even, you know, the gap of protection that exists in this legal framework is going to grow bigger. We have people that deserve protection for many different reasons, but we not find it in the Geneva Convention. So instead of, you know, expanding the protection regime, instead of, you know, finding new ways to protect people, we are seeing the other way around. People, states actually restricting even further, even what exists in the legislations. And one of the big fears is that if we reopen the definition of a refugee, so someone that, you know, finds protection for because of persecution for the race, religion, political opinions, there's many different criteria. Even to reopen that, the risk is that we will end up with something even more restrictive than what we have today. But many people are falling into the protection gap. They serve protection and they are not finding it at this moment.
Yeah, it seems like the crisis or the crises are getting, you know, bigger and worse to come, and states are doing less and less. And instead of kind of rising to the occasion to kind of rethink policies, and you know, we're trying to fill gaps where we can, but as a humanitarian organization, our mandate is, you know, is very focused. I think that raises another issue. When we do this work, we talk a lot at MSF about the importance of témoignage, or speaking out, as quite central to our mission. But when we speak out for and with refugees, we're often accused of being too political, especially when we're talking about this in the context of the Americas and in Europe. So I wonder, you know, do you think, are we getting too political? I'm curious what your thoughts are about that criticism. Sergio, you want to take that first?
Well, I can. I think we need to be human. We are a humanitarian organization. And obviously, we are getting into the debate, and we are adding to the debate on who should be a refugee and everyone that is outside that that political definition at the end, right? But beyond that, we see people suffering, we see people risking their lives with no choice. And honestly, our teams in front of the people, when they are taking care, when they are giving a consultation, providing mental health, they are not thinking about what's the political figure of these people. We have people suffering. And I think it's important for us as an organization to push in the public space on that. We are talking about people. It's not a matter of which level we are putting to these people. We are talking about people in need, people that have no choice, that are taking very difficult routes, that are risking their lives, and that's not for free. They are doing that, obviously. People like you or me, I'm Spanish, I'm very culturally near. I mean, I'm very near culturally of the people we are treating in Mexico. And I see people like I could be them, like normal families that one day they need to move because there is nothing more for them in the countryside, in El Salvador or in Honduras. They go to the town, they try to find life there, but they are immersed in a violent environment. The children are absorbed by the maras and the criminal groups, and they are forced to flee. And they were, I don't know, they were economists, or they were people living in the countryside. I mean, you have people like us that suddenly they need to move. And from our point of view, when we are providing this medical care, it really doesn't matter if they are moving because of the climate change, the hurricanes, the drought, or the violence. Mm-hmm. They are persecuted or not. They don't have the choice. They need assistance. They need protection, whatever we are, what's the level, the label we are putting on it. And it's very clear. And I think we don't need to be political, even if we are accused or not. I mean, we don't need to enter there. We're talking about human beings in need. And that's all. And that's blank. And that's easy to understand.
Very well said. Aurélie, did you have more to add?
No, I think it's, I mean, Sergio said it all. It's about saving lives, you know, and if it has to become a political choice, then that's, you know, that's what needs to be done. But I don't think it's more political to talk about asylum in the US or in Europe than in Kenya or South Sudan. Mm-hmm. I think there is, of course, we're talking about borders, we're talking about state sovereignty, so it's always a very sensitive issue. But MSF has been helping refugees since we exist. It's been 50 years now. So we have not become more political. We've always done this type of work. Mm-hmm. And what we care about is for people to be treated with dignity, to access healthcare and get the protection they deserve, that they really do deserve. So that's, that's what humanitarian action is about.
That's great. Thank you. And a reminder to everybody, if you're tuning in now, you can submit your questions via the chat feature. So keep them coming. We have a question from Antoinette who asks, what is it like to work with people who have been away from their home, their family, their livelihoods for so long? So I wonder if either of you have any personal stories, any testimonies that stand out for you?
There's so many.
Do you want to start with your recent, you were in Greece recently?
Yeah, I was in Greece a few months ago, and it's always hard because I go, you know, I mean, I've been following these projects that we have on the Greek islands. I was in Lesbos.
And actually, maybe take the audience back a bit about how long people have been on the Greek islands and what's happening there.
I mean, these islands have been, they have a long history of refugee issues because the population themselves, they were refugees once, and they have seen people from Afghanistan, from Iran, from the Middle East mostly arriving since the end of the 90s, beginning of the years 2000s, with small numbers. But obviously the numbers of people have increased because for a very simple reason is that the European Union have closed its external borders. They've even like physical fences that have been built at the Greek-Turkish border. We know you have different walls everywhere. So people have been forced to arrive by sea. And that's a key concern because obviously it's still a minority of people who arrive irregularly in Europe. Most of displaced people, refugees, they are not coming to Europe. They are in the south. They are living very different lives. But that's the main focus of the policies today, these people arriving irregularly by sea because they have no other choice. So, of course, the number of people have been increasing quite a lot in the last years with, of course, the, you know, 1 million people who entered through these routes to Europe in 2015. And since then, very, very restrictive policies put in place with people now being contained in very bad camps on these islands, waiting to be either returned or to get this very challenging access to an asylum procedures, which is really reduced, as I was saying. So it's very hard because we see, each time I go back there, I see things getting worse. I see the treatment of people getting worse and people really losing hope. It's about its families, its children. There's many, many children. It's a lot of people who have fled war and destruction. And the harm that is being done to them in these places is unacceptable. It's really, it's, you know, it's that's the most revolting thing is that it's not just because they flee war that they are in this situation. It's they are put in this situation by the government that wants to deter them from coming. It's really punishment. And that's the new normal. And it's normalized. Nobody's questioning it. We see children self-harming. We have hundreds of people of children with very, very severe mental health distress. Even some attempted suicide as young as 10 years old. So it's really, it's heartbreaking when you talk to these people because they, states have taken away their hope and their life and what makes them, able to survive basically. So that's, so yes, there are plenty of stories and it's really heartbreaking.
Yeah, so we've done a lot of documentation reporting on the mental health crisis, right? That is just keeps getting worse. I think, Sergio, you also see the mental health issues in Mexico quite acutely. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, definitely. We have in Mexico City, we have a center for victims of extreme violence and torture. 95% of our users still today, they're migrants, basically. A lot of them have suffered torture or have suffered this extreme violence already in their places of origin, and they try to move to a better life, or they try to go to the US, and they end up by having and receiving more violence along the road. A number of them, they finish in our center, and we have an holistic approach there. They stay with us for months. We try to give them the tools to live. In fact, about suicide that she was talking earlier, I mean, we have 92, 94% of our patients have tried to. So it's really a hard life, and it's really very hard situations. We have, I mean, it's very hard for our colleagues to work there too, because you are listening very hard stories and you are working in a very, very, I mean, it's human misery. It's really the extreme of this work, and it's very hard to work with people that have been so affected on the physical side a lot of times also, but on the mental health side, right? Mm-hmm. One of the criteria to enter the center is having lost functionality. So we're talking about people that cannot live a normal life as a consequence of the violence they have suffered. When we link that to this identification you may have with these people, I remember a family in Nuevo Laredo that was during the MPP time, the migrant protection protocol, the remaining mm-hmm. Mexico time, right? So we had a patient, the family, they were kidnapped basically in the border with Texas. And after the man was forced to work with the organized crime, kind of trying to buy their freedom, whatever, finally they arrived. I mean, they managed to be free. They crossed to the US, and the US authorities, they were asking for asylum. They were already fleeing violence from their place of origin and having a 3,000 miles trip, very hard, 2 to 3 months to arrive to the border. And then the U.S. border authorities, they put them and they send them back 500 meters of the house where they were kept while kidnapped by the organized crime. Mm-hmm. So that was an example of everything for me. It was an example of a normal family we could be identified with. They had a normal life. Everything crumbled because of a violent environment around them. They need to move. They move. They have a violent road. They arrive to a place. They have a huge shock too with this kidnapping and everything. And when they think they are in a safe place, and they do, they are in a safe place, and they have the right or not, but they are asking for asylum. They are asking for protection. And what they receive a detention of 2-3 days and send them back to the same place they have suffered all this violence that is not their home even. They are not even Mexicans, you know? I think we honestly, sometimes we don't realize what a migration policy is having as an impact. And again, I think we should push to put the human being and to talk about human stories, because we are talking about that. It's, mm-hmm. it's nothing but that we are talking here, right?
Yeah, exactly. That's a devastating story. And I do think it captures so many of the different strands, and you really see how this affects, you know, this one family. We're getting a question from the live stream that brings up, you mentioned the involvement of criminal gangs. And when Yop I'm not sure if I'm pronouncing your name correctly, so apologies, asks that some people say that by helping refugees, humanitarian organizations are also supporting human trafficking organizations in the US and in Europe. And how do you prevent this trafficking is the question. How do we navigate that?
I can maybe go first, Aurélie. I think it's criminalization that is feeding really the human trafficking, right? We have, it's very clear on the road. We are working from Panama to Mexico now, and to the US border, in fact. So you can see very clearly those countries that are allowing people to move and to cross them. People doesn't need to hide, doesn't need to go to the forest. They can take a bus. They have much less problems with violence, and there is no this criminal organization trafficking them. There is no need for that. There is not a market for that. If you want to put this in economical terms, right? In Mexico, they need to hide. They cross from what, I mean, Hondurans or Salvadorians, they can move freely in Guatemala, that's fine, till they arrive to the border. We have a program in near the border with Mexico, in Guatemala. We have women coming and asking for antiretroviral prevention for pregnancy. I mean, they know they are going to be raped. They know once they enter Mexico. And the only changing factor is this freedom to move. Is Mexican government is will deport them if they are detained. So we'll prosecute them. And this is pushing them to, they are criminalized, if you want to say like that. Mm-hmm. So they are pushed to the bush. They are exposed to violence. And then is the whole market created on them, right? To traffic them. So basically, we can see things the other way around. And migration policies are really feeding these criminal gangs.
Yeah.
When you are working in the border, in the northern Mexican border as a coyote, and suddenly the pandemic came and less people were moving and your business were down. I'm sorry, I'm very blunt on that. I mean, mm-hmm. it's like that, right? So you are having less people crossing, but the United States, with the excuse of the pandemic, to avoid to spread the virus in the United States, they are sending back people, even if they are not Mexican. People are sent back to Mexico. Well, this is also putting at risk Mexican side. That's clear. But in fact, if coyotes, they are taking the same people once and again, because they are just sent back, so they have more markets. So it's, mm-hmm. so when you are on the ground, you have the perception that it's the other way around, and really that migration policies and hardening migration policies, each time they are hardened, they are feeding more and more the criminal business around that. And it's very clear on the ground. So you can see the other way around. I think we need to, and we should push for safest roads. We should push for those needing protection to have them, regardless the label you are putting to them, as we were mentioning before. And this is very clear. And I have the impression that they are just an excuse sometimes, these human trafficking gangs, right? Like mm-hmm. we are feeding them on this.
Again. Well, yeah, we say these harsh migration policies are driving migration underground and really enriching these smuggling networks. So I think we also see this in Europe. And I'm curious, Arlene, I mean, this is, again, one of our most controversial activities probably are our search and rescue operations in the Mediterranean Sea. Since first launching in 2015, we've sent medical teams on board 7 rescue ships mm-hmm. and have provided life-saving assistance to more than 81,000 people. But, you know, why are we even doing this work?
Yes, we can. It's a good question, because it's becoming so difficult to rescue people at sea. And knowing that search and rescue is a legal obligation, it's the obligation of all shipmasters, and to think how difficult it has become just to be able to rescue people at sea in the Mediterranean Sea that will drown either way. So, I mean, if we don't rescue them, they are for sure not reaching destination. So we have a ship at the moment, actually, that is that has rescued several hundred people and that is waiting for a place to disembark. And states are refusing to allow this disembarkation, which is also a legal obligation. People that are rescued at sea needs to be brought to a place of safety by law. It's international maritime law. And as MSF, we continue despite all odds and despite the fact that we are also, I mean, talking about human trafficking, we are accused of working with human traffickers, and we are criminalized as we speak in Italy, for example. We have legal proceedings against our organizations and our members for this specific activity of rescuing people at sea. And despite that, we have to continue because every year we have hundreds of people who drown, who go missing. And we're talking on, if we talk about the route between Libya and Italy, we are actually talking about people fleeing human traffickers. People that are escaping torture, ill treatment, slavery, and that are put back in these detention centers as soon as they are intercepted and brought on ships of the Libyan Coast Guards that are funded by Europe. So we are accused of being the traffickers when Europe is putting people back in the hands of people. And something very important that, you know, and I completely agree with what Sergio was saying, is that people will come back. They will try again. People that have pushed, that I've met many people who have been pushed back at all borders, at the Hungarian border, the Serbian borders, Bosnian borders, Greece borders, they will try again because they have no other choice. Mm-hmm. So they try 15 times sometimes. I've met people that have been pushed back 15 times and sometimes very violently. So indeed, it's the problem is the lack of safe and legal passage. We need safe and legal avenues so that smugglers and human traffickers are out of business. That's the only way.
Yeah, I always think of that famous poem by Warsan Shirin: "No one leaves home unless home is the mouth of a shark." And I think that really captures for me, you know, the extreme situations that people are in. And we are seeing more and more, even this, like, transcontinental migration, especially to the Americas. And Sergio, you mentioned a few times what the new work in Panama and along the border. Can you talk a little bit about the kind of changing patterns of migration that you're seeing?
Well, it's a road that is increasingly used. In fact, we are working in Panama, in the border with Colombia. You have the Darien rainforest. It's very exotic place. They are discovering new species of animals constantly there. You know, it's kind of one of these unexplored places in the world. And people are taking 7 to 10 days to cross it. We are working now on the Panama side after they crossed from Colombia. Main nationality we see today is Haiti, after Cubans. And after that, the third one is from Nepal. They're Nepalese working, crossing there. You have Afghans, Palestinians, Burkina Faso, Cameroon. You have people around the world trying to reach the United States, crossing a very dangerous rainforest in Panama, which is still 5,000 miles to the US border. It's amazing, it's incredible, and it's really sad. It's very dangerous to cross this forest. You have a lot of natural dangers. They are suffering, I mean, hunger, lack of water. It's raining almost the all year round, and a lot of people have drowned because you have some very sudden waters coming with the rains. We have terrible témoignages, terrible stories explained by people who have seen they have been raped, and after they have witnessed how some companions were killed in front of them. There is no law, obviously, in this rainforest. Mm-hmm. It's just 7-10 days between Colombia and Panama with no law at all. You have some people bring in and some kind of guides, obviously paid to cross people through the forest, but life is just, I mean, this there's no price for you. I mean, you are nothing in the middle of that forest. And we have very terrible, terrible stories. We have seen so many sexual violence in this place, as in the rest of Mexico, which is already very, very violent for the rest of the year. It's incredible the number of violent events happening in this tiny, tiny portion of the road. And as you were mentioning, Kavita, is just this is somebody from Gaza trying to reach the U.S. in the middle of, we are almost in South America. It's in the Panama rainforest. It's just amazing thinking that if you arrive there, it's because of your choice. This is, I mean, it's unbelievable. It's just too risky, too dangerous, and incredible what we are witnessing today. And this road is more and more used, you know.
Yeah, wow, it's horrific to think about that odyssey and then what lies at the other side after all of that. I'm curious to reflect, you know, this is our 50th anniversary of MSF. We've done this work for decades. We've seen, you know, some of the changes in migration. Like, what are some of the things that we've learned, some of the experience that we've gained in our response to the needs of migrants and refugees? And, you know, how have these lessons informed more recent interventions? This is a question from Michael on the chat.
Yeah, we learned a lot because we had to adapt quite a lot while still keeping the same expertise to respond to the old challenges. So we see today, of course, that refugee camps are still places where, unfortunately, assistance is too limited, where people have no prospect, where they are staying even longer than before. We have more and more protracted refugee crisis. So we need to continue as MSF to be able to respond to this form of displacement. And we see new camps appearing and most camps that look like prison, like we have talked about Lesbos, but we see that more and more. So camps are becoming really like detention centers and prisons, unfortunately, for asylum seekers and refugees. So we had to learn more and more to respond in detention settings, which is a very complicated intervention because it requires to really know your place, what impact you can have, to have teams that are prepared to work in detention and detention-like conditions. It's very, very tricky. While not, you know, promoting the system, not being complicit in the detention system, so it is quite challenging. And we've developed quite a lot of expertise in different places in the world working in these type of conditions. And then we had to adapt to what Sergio was explaining: people in transit, people that have not arrived yet, that are stranded at borders. Then rescue, you know, people that need to be rescued because they are at the most dangerous borders we can imagine, in the middle of the sea, in the middle of the forest. We had to develop quite a lot of expertise in responding to all forms of violence, including ill treatment and torture. So we have developed expertise on that. So we really had to diversify the type of assistance we provide while keeping the old school emergency response that you can still have in different countries when you have a sudden influx of refugees across the border in DRC, in the Democratic Republic of Congo, or in South Sudan, or, you know, or internally displaced people, which are also, I mean, the most common form of displacement in the world today. So it's it's many challenges, but it's also important that we respond to all forms of displacement, and not only in the south, but also in the north, in Europe, in the US, in other countries where we see very, very severe needs as well.
Yeah, and you made this important point earlier too about how most migration is not south to north or, you know, east to west. It's like people tend to be internally displaced or to move just within the region. And so there is a misperception, especially in the United States and in Europe, about even the nature of the global picture. So,
and it's dangerous because this perception erodes the rights of all refugees. Mm-hmm. It's really, really dangerous, this misperception.
Looking ahead, there are some people who have asked about MSF's response to climate migrants and kind of this threat of even more massive displacement going forward. How are we prepared to respond?
Well, I think it's a key challenge, and I don't think we are yet really, you know, we don't have yet the full understanding of how climate change is already affecting how people are moving today, because also people are, you know, they don't know how to explain why they have, you know, like when you lose everything, you don't say, oh, I fled because of climate change. That's not how people phrase the reasons that push them to cross borders. But for sure, I mean, a lot of the advocacy we're doing for states to actually expand protection rather than restrict it, for better responses at border, for more humane migration policies. This is also in light of the challenge ahead, which is, you know, it's important that we look at the evidence, that we look at the fact it's not, you know, we should not accept that this is the way forward, that there's no other way. Mm-hmm. Because this is not working in terms of reducing migration flows, like this deterrence approach, this containment policies, the externalization of borders to other countries, things we're saying in, you know, in many different regions. There is another way. And we know that if states are not prepared to host more people that are displaced by many different factors, then we're going to continue seeing crises at borders like we do, and we're going to see more situations of despair and more needs. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And coming back to this idea, I mean, there are often multiple and overlapping factors. And I think that nature of mixed migration, multiple push factors, like we see that a lot in the Americas as well. And these are not future threats. This is, you know, things that are happening right now. I think, Sergio, you've seen when you've interviewed people who are coming, you know, making the journey north from Honduras, there are multiple factors, you know, cycles of drought, flooding, hurricanes, as well as violence, poverty, you know, there's so many different things happening, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's, as Olivia was mentioning, people, sometimes they we have difficulties explaining when we left, and that's, mm-hmm. that's very clear. And everything is having an influence. Obviously, we have two hurricanes in Honduras in the past months, and you see that there are a lot of people, tens of thousands, they lost everything. When they are in a very fragile balance already, if you have a changing factor, that will force you to move. And this can be mixed and overlapping factors, as you were mentioning, like violence and economic factors or the drought or the hurricane, right? Everything is mixed, and the fact is that you don't have the choice, you need to move. And when you see all these people taking these dangerous paths in Europe, the Mediterranean, or the Americas, I mean, you have no chance. You will do the same, Kavita or me, Sergio, whoever, in that situation. You will try to have a better life for your family or a life, if your life is threatened, that's clear. So I think at the same time that I don't think we should, as an organization, put the focus into level if someone is refugee or has the right to be refugee or not. I don't think we need to put the stress or to stress to about the reasons of moving or taking that. But when we see, and regardless the people we see, they have very little choice or no choice but to move. And this should be the center of our approach, I think, as human beings, not only as humanitarian organization. And this day that we are commemorating, celebrating next Sunday, I think is the perfect day to remember that, right? That mm-hmm. we are talking about people and we don't need to label them, but suffering and human suffering at the end, right?
Yeah, that's absolutely, that's we're coming up to time, and I think that that's actually where we should start and where we should end is really coming back to these people. And, you know, we see medical needs and we address them, and that's what it comes down to. So I want to thank everybody. Thank you, Aurélie, and thank you, Sergio, for your time. This has been a really fascinating conversation. It's very stark, you know, to kind of be confronted with the needs, but it's also, I think, reassuring to know what can be done. I mean, we can respond, we can do better, and we must. So I think, thank you all for joining us. Apologies if we didn't get to your question, but please stay in touch and stay connected with MSF. You can email the team at event.rsvp@newyork.msf.org. And for more information, you can always visit our website, which is doctorswithoutborders.org. And you can also follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and beyond. So take good care and goodbye. Thank you again.
Thank you.
Be well.